Thanks for being here, Dara.
You bet.
Hey, Dara. Welcome.
Good seeing you. Thanks. You're right there. All right, this is great stuff. So, Dara, we've had a chance to talk with you. This is now the second time. So now here come the tough questions. Now that we got an audience.
If you've been armed by Rich, I'm very afraid.
He said, Rich actually said you have a good rapport and you were on stage
recently.
We have a great rapport.
I've learned a lot from Rich.
What have you learned from Rich?
You know, early on, I was while I was an engineer to start with, I went into the evil world of finance investment banking. And Rich really early on, when I took over Expedia, he pushed very much the importance of core technology, core architecture, and engineering talent. It took me a couple of years to learn about it, but now it is my religion. And I can say, Rich, you're absolutely right.
Yeah, that's great.
So how has the company transformed from the days that it was spun out of Microsoft by Rich Barton to today? I mean, and you just celebrated your 20th anniversary?
Yeah, we're old. It's
just
horrible.
Old, yeah. So how have you been able to retain maybe that entrepreneurial culture at the company, even at 20 years?
So the key is for us to organize in different units that are separate, that do their own thing, and can remain entrepreneurial. We're a lot of brands that came together through mergers and acquisitions. And integration and M&A and innovation are not friends. The two don't go well together. And when we first brought in all these brands, we tried to integrate them all into one core architecture, et cetera, in order to get lots of economics out of these deals where we paid a lot of money for those deals. That turned out to be a mistake because it stifled innovation. It required lots of people to have lots of meetings before they did anything. And then we wisened up and essentially rebuilt our architecture from the ground up. Took hundreds of millions of dollars. I still remember going to our board of directors and said, I need, you know, a couple hundred million dollars and I don't know what the return is, but I think it's a good thing to do. That was not a fun meeting. But as we rebuilt the architecture, we architected the company so that Hotels.com and Expedia and Trivago and HomeAway, et cetera, are run quite independently. They've got their own presidents, they've got their own CTOs. There's no Expedia Inc. CTO. Every single one of the presidents has their own CTO. It creates a circumstance where sometimes you're building features two or three times amongst the different brands, but it allows you to move so much faster and it pushes responsibility down into the organization. And you know, you want great employees, they want to add value, but they want the freedom to move when they think that they see the right thing to do. And we're architecting our business to allow them to move without asking permission.
So we're looking now at this is a graphic we created of the Expedia suitcase.
Thank
here
you.
With the gnome and everybody. One of those brands on that list, Trivago, you're talking about spinning them off. Can you explain this to me? Because you just bought HomeAway, right?
Yeah.
This is a multi-billion-dollar business.
Yes.
And Trivago is another, you know, very sizable business. Why spin it off? I honestly don't get this.
So you don't get it because we're not spinning them off. We're actually taking them public,
okay.
Which is different from a spinoff.
Understood.
And essentially, when we bought Trivago, the founders of the company own about a third of the business. We own two-thirds of the business. And this is a way of getting the founders some liquidity, of creating kind of a liquid stock out there for employees of Trivago. We think it'll be a good thing, but we will still be the majority owner of Trivago. It's simply an IPO. It's not a spinoff.
Okay. So,
and you're right, a spinoff would make no sense.
Yeah, okay. So in that context, though, is that something that you could envision following with some of your other brands? I'm trying to get a sense of whether the flow is in or out, and that's what's confusing.
You know, I'd say it depends. It depends on the circumstance. It depends on the brand. Trivago is a particularly independent brand because its client base includes us and some of our biggest competitors. So it has to be quite separate. It has to always view the consumer as king. And it can't take orders from us. Otherwise, they're not optimizing for the consumer. And if you don't optimize for the consumer on the internet, you're dead. So that is a brand that we've kept particularly independent. And to the extent that we can source terrific talent, especially in Europe, as a result of this business being public, that's a good thing for us, and we're going to go ahead. And I think with Trivago, I can't speak too much of it because there's a IPO filing that's coming up. But it is one of the great European internet companies, and it will have the profile that it deserves after this IPO.
Yeah. So the online travel industry is sometimes referred to as a duopoly with Expedia and Priceline. Do you agree with that assessment?
I think it's becoming more of a duopoly, but ourselves and Priceline together are less than 10% of the total travel ecosystem. You know, travel is a $1.4 trillion marketplace. It's enormously fragmented. And we do believe that that fragmentation deserves to be consolidated. Ourselves and Priceline, I would say, are the share gainers in the travel industry, and we're growing faster than the average travel industry, but it's a very fragmented marketplace, and hopefully both companies have years and years of growth ahead of them because of that.
Yeah.
So there's been chatter that there could be another entrant coming in, which scares the pants off of most companies. Amazon's been talked about coming into the travel market. What do you think? They're obviously a big e-commerce player, as you are. What do you think about their potential entrance, and does that scare you?
Well, my pants are still on right now.
Thank you,
fortunately,
for
everyone here. But listen, Amazon is a company that you've got to take very, very seriously. They have made forays into travel in the past, as you know, one with Partnership for Us, and then there was a local business that they had in travel, and they've gone out. And we can't control what Amazon does, what Google does, what Facebook does. What we can control is building incredible experiences and services for consumers. So if Amazon comes in and we hear about they're getting into travel, that won't be a happy day for us because it's a very competitive field. But we think that we can more than hold our own in this environment.
What sets travel apart in e-commerce versus other e-commerce transactions that gives you comfort that you might be able to have a pretty strong moat around your business?
Well, I think scale on the internet gives pretty good moats. As long as you've got scale, as long as you are then investing aggressively behind that scale and innovating and creating a great customer experience, usually good things happen. And we are aggressively, we're very, very aggressively reinvesting both in marketing and especially in technology to kind of stay ahead of the pack. That the minute you stop improving on the internet, someone catches up and takes over, and we don't want to be there. And I think that travel is also a truly global game. There are very few goods and services that are truly cross-border services. When we open up a storefront in Germany, we have to acquire all kinds of inventory in Germany, hotels, car rentals, et cetera, that are available to all of our consumers all around the world. So our opening up in Germany makes my service for an American traveling to Germany actually better. That's not true of a lot of other e-commerce categories. So I think you've got scale advantages, you've got global advantages, and as long as you keep reinvesting behind those advantages, I think you will be in a good spot.
So just a programming note, I'm actually going to follow along on the Twitter stream here. So just use the hashtag GW Summit, and if you have a question for Dara or us up here, just hammer it out there on Twitter, and I'll see if we can get it incorporated.
So we put this together. This is your life basically right here, the last 10 years.
Yes.
So I mean, if you look at this growth, I mean, this is just astronomic, and the idea, and especially on the employee side, how do you manage this? Because obviously, some of this is from acquisitions, but a lot of it's organic as well.
It is. And I'd say our employee growth has been faster than we ever imagined it. We're always catching up to kind of a real estate footprint. And I think the way that you manage it is you put the right people in the right places, and then you trust them to do the right stuff. It requires a very strong core culture. And our core culture is one about being different. It's about valuing the employee. And then trusting them to do the right thing for the company. And so far, it's worked for us. But honestly, you know, getting to 20,000 employees, getting to 30,000 employees, and making sure that this is still a wonderful place to work, where the individual can make a difference, where the individual can be the best person that they can be, that's a real challenge. And it'll continue to be a real challenge for us.
The other thing that struck me in putting this together was 2008. Holy crap.
Yeah, that was not fun.
Yeah.
2008.
So how did you recover from that? And what lessons did you learn?
You know, the great thing about 2008 is, and surviving it, and not only surviving it, but to some extent thriving through it, is that what we found out is people may put off a car purchase, or they may put off kind of the kitchen remodel. They still want to go on their summer vacation. And they may kind of downsize from a 4-star hotel to a 3-star hotel, or they, instead of going to Hawaii, they may go to Mexico. They still want to take their vacations. They still want, I think that people treasure these experiences, and I think that our culture is moving towards valuing experiences more than stuff. So 2008 hurt because prices came down, and we certainly had a big loss in 2008, but we leaned forward through that period. And one of the things that, Barry Diller, who's our chairman, always says is, you want to have a company that can have a balance sheet, kind of this lock, stock, and barrel strong balance sheet that allows you to lean forward during periods of uncertainty. Because when everyone else is pulling back, if you lean forward, that's when you gain share. And that's certainly the experience that we had in 2008, 2009.
How did you instill that in the culture and the people? Because I'm sure people were nervous and scared during that time frame. So
yeah,
how did that translate from that big theory down to the employees and the full culture?
So one of the early lessons that I learned in leadership is that it's the leader's job to always go kind of against the flow. And I think sometimes leaders get this wrong, which is when things are bad, and you know one of your teams is having a tough time, they know they're having a tough time. They don't need you to go out there and say, you know, your results are crap. What the hell are you going to do about it? They actually need you
to
lift them up.
Have you seen Todd's management style?
This could be. Yes. You know, so they need, you know, as a manager, you've got to go against the flow.
Yeah.
So in 2008, 2009, we kept saying the drumbeat was the world is crazy. People are still going to travel. Travel isn't going to end. We're going to be fine. We've got an incredible balance sheet. Push, 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 focus. And by the way, you're going to have a job. Don't worry about your job. And so we kind of we constantly go against. And when things are good, we actually push down. You know, it's very tempting as a manager when things are great to say, hey, you're doing amazingly well. Don't worry about a thing. Keep doing. Those are times when I'm tougher on the team. And I tell my team to be tougher on their team when things are great. Because when things are great is when you loosen up, when you lose discipline, when you let things go, when you're not as demanding on yourself or your team as you should be. But when things are tough, you know, as long as you believe in your team and you believe in your strategy, that's when you go against and say, you know what, things are fine. We're going to push, we're going to grow, keep going.
So where are you at now on that spectrum? You pushing on them or are you?
I've been pushing. I think that the last 5 or 6 years have been really good years for us. Yeah. And I don't want us to get fat and happy.
Yeah.
How do you prevent that from happening? What do you say to them?
Listen, you push and keep discipline. In meetings, you're tougher than you usually would be. And, you know, I do something called porpoising, which is you always want to keep your eye on the big picture, but once in a while you have to go very, very deep on a particular issue to make sure that the company is working with real discipline all the way down at multiple layers within the company. So as long as you kind of dive deep where appropriate, you can instill the kind of discipline that you need in a company to be able to keep it together and thrive with the kind of growth that we've had on a global basis.
Porpoising.
Dive
Got
deep.
It.
Okay.
Got
dive
it.
Deep.
Yes.
Good. So let's talk about alt travel. This is the new phrase that we picked up from Rich, who's our informant on the.
Well, let's ask people how many people have used a Airbnb, home away,
VRBO.
VRBO. How many people have actually used one?
Yeah. Okay, you have, wow.
So over half, certainly.
Wow, definitely.
So
for how
a
many
lot of people know about
yeah,
alt travel.
Yeah, for yeah. How many of you is it the first place you go when you have to travel on business or personal?
A lot fewer hands.
Wow.
Less than 15%.
Interesting. So this plays right into your hands, Dara, because a big part of the idea is you integrate these home away listings into Expedia. If I understand correctly, you've gone from about 230,000 hotel partners to over 1 million properties when you started integrating HomeAway listings.
Absolutely right. Now I do think that HomeAway itself is going to stand on its own as a brand, as an operation in Austin, very independent, focused very much on the whole home. And there are certain people, I know when I go on vacation, I've got 4 kids and I bring in-laws, etc. Often I look for a whole home when we go away for Christmas, etc. That HomeAway brand speaks to me during those occasions. And I think that one thing that the press kind of has wrong is it's this either or. You know, either Airbnb is going to win and HomeAway is going to win, or the hotels are going to win. It's either or. And I don't think it's that black and white, because we found that different travelers have traveled differently based on occasions. And so HomeAway is going to be its own vertical. It's a powerful brand. It's growing really, really well. And at the same time, we are going to move the HomeAway inventory into Expedia, hotels.com. And based on the kind of searches that we see, so for example, if you're doing a one-night search Wednesday in New York City, we probably won't present, you know, an apartment or a whole home to you because that's probably business travel. But if it's on a weekend and you've got kids and it's for a week, we will probably surface that kind of inventory to you much more aggressively. So there's going to be a lot of testing and learning here, but we think the interconnection between the two brands is going to be pretty powerful.
Did this surprise you by the rapid uptake of it? I mean, because when you think about it on the surface, it is kind of a crazy idea that you're going to, you know, what was called couch surfing at the time. You're going to spend the night in somebody's, on somebody's couch or spare bedroom or, you know, cabin in their backyard. Did it take you by surprise, the trend?
I think that aspect of it definitely. You know, I was surprised as kind of this C2C and home sharing aspect of it was a surprise. But vacation home rental has been around for years and years and years. So that's where HomeAway is, which is a whole home. You're not, you know, I don't think we're going to get into the couch sharing or the room sharing business. That business has been around for a long time. All we're doing is we're just wiring it up, just like we wired up independent hotels over the last, you know, we spent over the last 15, 20 years wiring up independent and branded hotels. Now we're just wiring up all these vacation homes so that they can be searched and booked incredibly efficiently. That part isn't a surprise. We'll see 5 years from now how much of it is sharing versus people using whole homes, et cetera. I think sharing, while it gets a lot of headlines, is probably a smaller percentage of the pie than kind of renting a whole apartment in one way
or the
other.
So it won't be the majority of travel bookings
It will be a segment. It'll be a segment, but I don't think it'll be the majority.
Yeah. Interesting. So one of the things you've done since acquiring HomeAway is, and that's fresh for you, don't worry.
Thank you very much.
So one of the things you've done is shifted the model in terms of your relationship with the actual property owners in a way that more closely matches Airbnb, the commission structure and all that sort of thing. You faced a bit of a backlash there. Have you gone too far?
I think the backlash has turned a lot more positive recently. I don't want to count my chickens. I think fundamentally we move HomeAway from a media listings product to a transactional product because consumers just like transactions more. They want to be able to search, they want to be able to see a live calendar, and they want to be able to book. And within the listings model, consumers, I know I've had to kind of you hunt and peck on HomeAway. You've got to send emails to four or five different owners. Some of them update their calendar, some of them don't. That is a much less optimal experience for a user than calendar is updated, book, either instant book or wait 24 hours to get a confirmation of that booking. So all we're doing is we're moving with the consumers. Consumers on the internet expect friction-free commerce. HomeAway had a lot of friction. We thought that was an opportunity, and we're moving it to a model that is much less friction. There's a vocal minority of our owners, we believe, that are complaining, but this movement allows a lot more transactions to happen and has allowed us to invest a heck of a lot more in marketing, which has brought more traffic to our owners. So I think we're over the hump, although I take nothing for granted.
So I'm interviewing Jeff Jordan of Andreessen Horowitz later this afternoon, Airbnb board member. What question should I ask him?
I would, I'd ask him whether Airbnb is going to get into the hotel business.
Oh, so you could potentially see them going the other way around, using their platform.
There's some talk about that. I don't think that it's something that would match their brand values, so I think it would be a tough road for them. But I think one position that I like about our company is that we have the full spectrum of travelers. And as you saw by the hands here, you know, every occasion is not the same. And I think that we can talk to every single travel occasion. And based on knowing you and your habits and your identity more and more with kind of in a social mobile world, we think that we can offer you the perfect product regardless of kind of your stating, well, I'm coming to HomeAway or Airbnb, et cetera. We've got the whole world for you. And we think that's a pretty good position to start with.
It's interesting. There are actually parallels to your original parent company, Microsoft, where they're coming from this traditional world of servers, moving into the cloud, but they're offering both. You're kind of doing the same thing, but you're competing against a company that's just doing this all travel, just like Microsoft's against AWS.
Yeah, and doing it very well. You know, the specialists in this industry have done very, very well.
So we did have an audience question come in. Lynn-Ann Bradbury of Centric had one that's been on my mind as well. Talk about VR and travel. What is that going to look like? Is that going to diminish our desires to go to physical places? And how is Expedia?
God, I hope not. I hope that VR and travel fails miserably, because I want people to go places. I think that VR, it's a long way away, first of all. I think that VR can certainly play a part in your research and travel and your being inspired to go to amazing places on Earth. I think from that standpoint, it can be a real positive to go experience, you know, if you experience the Eiffel Tower in VR, maybe you want to experience the real thing, and I can guarantee you the real thing is going to be better than the VR experience, at least for a while. So I think from that standpoint, content that creates inspiration for you to go places, that'll be terrific. Will VR replace the actual experience? I doubt it.
What are you doing to invest, or are you even thinking, is this on your radar?
We are.
In terms
we have,
of what
we,
you're trying to do, because it can be a marketing tool.
Yeah, we have some VR kits, actually, that we're playing with actively. And right now, it is about working with destination organizations, tourism boards, et cetera, to use VR as an extra oomph to really promote their destinations and then working with them on that promotion. I think it's a great potential as far as really building a much richer experience as to what you can expect when you go into destination.
Okay, so when I go to Kauai in my VR world, it's not gonna replace dipping my toes in the Pacific.
It'll always be sunny, which is cool, but it's not gonna replace your dipping your toes.
Well, it's interesting because you actually did something, the company did something with St. Jude Children's Hospital where your employees took 360-degree cameras, live cameras, out into the places that the children
into
had
the
wanted
field.
To visit.
Yeah.
And then there was an immersive room. I actually thought,
we live streamed it.
Right.
We live streamed this experience for these kids. It was amazing.
It was fantastic, and I realized that was in part a philanthropic venture. But I looked at that and I thought, wait a second, are you thinking of getting into real-time travel experiences?
I think, you know, that we wanted to do something exceptional and amazing for these kids who had these dreams that we could help fulfill those dreams in a really special way, and we've got an incredible relationship with them, so it really made sense. St. Jude's is a terrific organization. I think that for the time being, we want to use VR as inspiration for you to really love something and want to go there. Can it be a replacement? I think that's far off at this point.
Okay. Let's talk about another aspect of the emerging technology that you've dabbled in, and that is chatbots. And we can play in the background here as we're talking an example of what Expedia is doing on Facebook Messenger.
Yep.
So this is your Facebook Messenger chatbot. We were talking about this earlier with the media panel. I struggle with this entire concept when I would much rather go to a keyboard, go to my phone, tap a couple buttons and book it, then interact with a bot that may or may not understand what I'm asking for. Defend this.
I won't defend it. I think it's kind of cool. But I think that chatbots at this point, the much better use of chatbots is actually for service. Okay, so what chatbots do is they do a couple of things which are cool. One is identity. Usually when you have mobile and social together, you know, these are personal devices, so we know your identity. Second is you can have a conversation that's dephased. You don't need to necessarily, you can type something in, do something else. And when you put those two together, you can have a service experience that I think is actually really cool, which is cancel my hotel in New York next week. And that's all I need to tell you versus calling someone, being on hold, what's your itinerary number, et cetera. It knows it's me, and it knows, and we will know that we have a hotel reservation for you next week in New York, and we just cancel it. Done. I think that's a great experience. I think that the search experience, which is please book me a hotel in New York, Midtown next week, I think the search and the query experience is much better served through voice. And if you look at what mobile has done with for companies, you know, first, right now, for companies like ours, we've had to adjust our services so that we deal with a smaller screen size. And essentially, you've gone from mouse to thumb. Okay. The next step is, as it relates, browsing is probably going to be thumb for a while. But querying of complex databases, and we have a pretty complex travel database, I think more and more is going to go to voice. And with voice, we have a problem because we can't train you. We've trained you. Tell us when you're going. Tell us where you're going. We'll give you a specific answer, et cetera. We can't train you to ask only for certain questions. So the kind of questions that you start getting are going to be much broader, are going to be much more random, and are going to be much more complex. And that, I think, creates a terrific opportunity for companies like ours to kind of stand head and shoulders above some of the other companies. You know, I want a nonstop flight to New York for two people, adjoining seats, with an aisle seat. I want to get in midday, and I'd rather get into Newark rather than JFK, and please get me a ride to my hotel. That could be a voice query, and I think, you know, if you tried to chat that, that would take forever, and that would kind of suck. But I think with a voice interaction, we can actually start answering those questions in an artful way.
Good.
So another audience question, and one that we wanted to address as well. Obviously, you made a big move about a year ago when you announced that you're going to move out of Bellevue to Seattle, out over to Elliott Bay, one of the most beautiful campuses probably in the world, right on Elliott Bay. But you've scaled back those plans a bit. So did you bite off more than you could chew in taking over the former Anjan campus
in Seattle? We just found, so first of all, you did the advertisement for us. It's the most beautiful.
Okay.
I mean, it's
amazing. I used to ride my bike through it when I went to the old PI building.
The view is spectacular.
It's fantastic.
It is just Seattle, Mount Rainier. It's amazing. And when we looked at the build, there was kind of a giant design that we first came out with that was great and sexy. And then there was a design that as we looked at it more, that was more incremental, that could serve us more gradually and cost a heck of a lot less and still be amazingly great. And you know, to the extent that you can invest less upfront and get a terrific return on investment, and the terrific return on investment here is kind of employee experience and environment, you take it. So it was just a better idea, and we let the better idea win.
Yeah, so actually, just after the lunch break, we're gonna have Scott Wyatt, who's a partner at MBBJ, one of the largest architecture firms in the world, who's speaking about space and why it matters and how it can make you more productive as an employee. So are your employees going to be productive looking out onto that view every day, or are they going to lose productivity?
We're going to block the view. We're going to say, you know, you can only see the view after 6 o'clock.
But space does matter, and where people work matters.
It does. And one of the great attractions of this space, in addition to the view, et cetera, is that the floor plates are big and broad, and we're right now in a skyscraper, and we love the big, broad floor plates because we're going to have a totally open environment, and it just allows great collaboration between teams, and you know, you're just in a good mood when you're there, and I think it'll be a terrific attractor of talent for us, especially technology talent, because that's what makes the place tick for us.
So did you feel like you had to be in Seattle because there's more buzz energy to get tech talent? Because I know a lot of your employees who are on the east side aren't too wild about this commute across not only the lake but across the city.
We're going to work to fix that commute. And actually, we've opened up a small office right next to the bigger site, so to speak, to work on the commute and to kind of optimize the commute for our employees. It wasn't a had to. It was just an amazing opportunity. It used to be an Amgen campus. There was a M&A deal, so they decided to get out of the site. It became available, and this is, it's going to be an iconic headquarters. Like, there's nothing else like it. And when you see an opportunity like that, you know, I talked about having a great balance sheet, et cetera, you take it, and we move fast. Kudos to the team for moving fast and really pulling that spot before it became available more broadly.
Yeah.
We just saw Amazon this week start piloting its own east side to Seattle bus service. You've signaled that you're essentially going to do the same thing. Is that one of the main ways that you're going to be managing this?
Definitely that, and I think the mass transit plans that are in place, they're going to improve the commute as well. But we're very much a test and learn culture. So we test and learn, we optimize. We already have a site on the east side, and we're going to learn a lot from that site.
Yeah. So one thing that we wanted to talk about was the broader geopolitical movements that are happening around the world. When you look at some of the proposals coming out of the U.S. presidential campaign, in particular, as they relate to borders and international travel, how could the outcome of this upcoming election impact your business?
Well, I think if one candidate wins, and you can guess whom, I think it'll be negative for the world, it'll be negative for travel. I mean, there's no other way of putting it. You know, I think that the great thing about our company is that we feel like we are bringing a terrific force to the world, which is people coming together, people understanding each other, breaking down barriers is fundamentally good. And I think that where, you know, Trump just has it dead wrong is, you know, this is a world of us versus them. And we don't believe in a world of us versus them. We view, we look at a world of all of us together. And so, you know, I'm rooting for a specific candidate. I'm rooting for Clinton. There's nothing wrong with that. And I think it'll be better for our business in particular.
Yeah, and I know we're going to talk about this tomorrow with Teddy Goff, who's the chief digital strategist for the Clinton campaign and worked with Obama. But it seems like the trend, that trend and that movement flies in the face of what we were talking about on the millennial panel, because the world is open to them. It's an open book. How are millennials shaping the future of travel?
Well, I think the millennials are flocking to experiences in a way that the older generations haven't. I think that there is a fundamental movement to valuing experiences versus stuff. If you look at the growth of the travel industry, it's been growing in excess of GDP by a couple of points over a couple of years. And I think it fundamentally goes to this, you know, your value at Expedia isn't based on how fancy your car is. It's where did you go on your last vacation and how freaking cool was that vacation? You know, we have a bunch of travel geeks who really value experiences, and I think that plays right into the millennial generation. So I think that we're kind of marketing the perfect product for millennials, and I think that's a stream that we can swim on for some time.
Yeah. We talked about virtual reality. We talked about chatbots. Any other technology on the horizon, something emerging that you and your teams are talking about right now that's really getting your attention?
Well, I think that we as a company are very much focused on the search and booking experience. And I think that experience has been built up, is going to be improved over a period of time. But there are two kind of bookend experiences that I think are very under-optimized. One is that once you're in market, it all falls apart. You know, when I book a hotel, I want to be able to walk into that hotel. I want to not be greeted by the front desk clerk who's asking me where I'm coming from. I kind of want to be left alone and get up to my room as fast as possible, right? So technology should enable that, and we have to work with our hotel partners better in order to enable that end-to-end flow of technology. Not only is it booking, but it's a stay, and it's a checkout, and it's the payment, et cetera. The other part is that all of our various sites are very good at serving consumers once they declare intent. You know, if I want to go to Boston in March 18th through March 21, we've got a great answer for you. But to the extent that you don't have intent, where should I go on my spring break vacation? You know, where should, I've got a week and I want a direct flight and I want to spend $2,000 no more for a week, what should I do? That kind of idea flow right now is coming from friends and family and magazines. That inspiration is something that really hasn't been well served on the web. I think that Facebook is in an interesting position there. Google is kind of the king of intent because you type into Google what you're researching, et cetera, and that data is very, very valuable. But there is a moment before intent that's a very valuable moment. This is, what should I do? You know, what's my inspiration? And I think that travel has not been particularly well served on that top end or on the bottom as far as once you're in market, what should I do? What's my experience like?
And so you'll have a presence across that.
Well, we're going to certainly work on it.
Will you offer a specific product to hotel partners to do that end to end?
So we have invested in companies, for example, Alice is a messaging service that is helping hotels kind of fulfill traveler needs, et cetera. We're making investments on that side. We are making very significant investments in destination things to do. So coming to Seattle, well, do you want to take a duck tour? Do you want to take a winery right. tour, et cetera? We've got the context that you're flying to Seattle on date X and Y, what hotel you're staying at, we can help you actually have more fun in Seattle, and we're investing in those technologies. So we're making spot investments, and then based on the ones that are successful, we go deeper.
That's great. Well, Dara Khosrowshahi from Expedia, thank you very much for being here. This has been excellent.
Thank you for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah. I think our timer was off. Thank you. Yeah. It's good to see you.